So this is the webinar series Upasana, the Envision the New Vedic Dimension, conducted by Vaigiri College Union of Ashtangam Ayurveda Vidyapeedam. So first of all, I welcome all of you to this webinar series on behalf of Vaigiri College Union. So we are planning weekly sessions on different topics. So today is our first session by our respected Vaidyan Ajayan Sadanandan sir, HOD of Dravyaguna Vijnaniyam of Ashtangam Ayurveda Vidyapeedam, on the topic understanding of global plant sources through Ayurvedic principles. So sir, let's start the session. Sir.
Good evening, everybody. Good evening, everybody. Hello, everybody can able to hear now? Hello.
Yes, sir, we can hear.
Yes. Okay. Good evening, everybody. Today we can discuss one of the important aspects that described in our classics regarding the principles of understanding of the plant sources through various theories. So how our acharyas are able to know about these plants and how much they are utilized various techniques to identify the plants, and then they included this in our pharmacopoeias and in our medicinal uses. So this knowing about these types of approaches of Dravyaguna can help to identify the importance of the plant sources that are available around the globe. And we can see these aspects of the ways how our acharyas are studied this science through various principles. So with all your permissions, we can start the topic, Global Understanding of Plant Sources by Ayurvedic Principles. If you look into the global scenario on this blue planet, we have 391,000 vascular plants. Vascular plants are those plants which are having a well-developed xylem, phloem, and transporting mechanisms. They are all, most of them are flowering plants. And among them, these 391,000, we know something very little about 31,000 of the plants. So if you look into the history of the medicines, the development of the medicines is start from the plant sources itself. The so-called modern pharmacological molecules, alkaloids, flavonoids, everything are came from the previous knowledge from the various medical sources that traditionally exist in the world. If you look into the history of such medicines, in 1775, Digitalis purpura, a plant that is used in the European countries for dropsy. So a grandmother lived on the outskirts of the European country. She used to give this Digitalis purpura for pedal edemas. And one doctor come to know that this medicine is working very nicely and edema is reducing, and those patients with dyspnea is also getting relieved by this medicine. And that doctor tried this drug
and then investigated through chemical analysis and led to the discovery of digitalin. Presently also the modern world using this digitalin, digitoxin like alkaloids for cardiac insufficiency. So like that, if you look into the history of malarial fever, 1820, quinine alkaloid is derived from Cinchona officinalis. In 1897, aspirin is came. The acetyl salicylic acid is came from a plant called Filipendula palmaria. The famous morphine, codeine, pethidine, all these are came from these marvelous painkillers are came from our ahibana. And reserpin for hypertension came from Rawalpindi serpentina. Like that, so many molecules, alkaloids, everything is came from the nature itself. So these are the knowledges that existed in the grassroots level of the common peoples. And then it is come to the mainstream, so-called chemical world. What's the importance of this means?
Informations that available in the world, we can see that only less than 20% of chemicals are evaluated for pharmacological studies. On that also, we are only able to isolate some 21,200 chemicals. On that, only 70% are subjected for single bioassay. Means the pharmacological studies are done on the different models, and then it came to the health practice as a medicine, that is only 70%. So it shows that we are very little known about the plant sources and its chemical constituents. And this type of approach of knowing the chemicals, isolating the chemicals, then after the chemical isolation, it is subjecting for a pharmacological study, and then going for a toxicity study, and then for a human trial, it will take more than 10 years, a long period. And so many scientists has to work together, and it needs millions of dollars. So this is a long process. And sometimes after this also, we are unable to know that this is good for this purpose also. So there comes the importance of our approaches or other ways to understand the nature and how our acharyas are utilized with these things in our medicines. So if you look into the Vedas, you can see that nearly 204 drugs are mentioned. But when it comes to the Samhitas, it reached up to 1,500. Then when we look into the Nigandhus, nearly 3,000 plants coming. So like that, the enrichment of pharmacopoeia is not a simple mere coincidence. On that, a specific way of studying these things and including these things in the pharmacopoeia is done by our acharyas. It is not an edarchavada. It is a systematic way of understanding the things through the Ayurvedic principles, and then it is incorporated in various medicines. So there we comes to the importance of knowing the flora, how we can know about this flora. So we can know this through one of the important pramanam, pratyaksha pramanam, that is the observational understanding. So first we have to utilize the observational understanding of a particular area. On that, we have to utilize the bhumi parisha, geographical, then the floral examination, then loka parisha samanyavada. There will be a similarity with the internal and external things that is existing in this world. So the micro appearance of our body is the same thing that is appearing on the external features as the macro. So the similarity of these things has to be assessed, and finding out the togetherness or the symbiotic relations with the living beings of the earth. So like this, these are the observations. Simple by observation only we can able to know that this will be useful for this purpose. So these observations and interpretations, anumanam, will help to know that certain knowledges we can gather, and that knowledge can be used for identifying the importance of plant. So there is a systematic way of these things are there. So first we will do the geographical examination so that we can able to know that what are the predominance of physical matters is there, because these physical matters will be influencing the plant sources also. So using the applying the panchabhautika tattvas, we will know that this bhumi has having this predominance and this will influence the plant also. That is the geographical understanding. And the second thing is the floral understanding. The seeing the plant, we can expect that these are the features that the plant has. And then the similarities with the nature and the human's body parts or the functional parts of the our body. Then the relationship with the different life forms externally and internally. So like that, these first steps are the systematic way of assessing, and we are gathering some of the assumptions through these informations, and we are not stopping in these assumptions and or the gathered knowledge, because we have to do bahuvidha parisha to attain a proper theory or a finding. For that purpose, we ratherly checking these things in different methods through first observation, then the second we will go for the perceptional understanding to analyze the data as what we are gathered through the observation, is it correct or not. For that we will use one by one parishas, that is the guna parisha first, then virya parisha first, second then rasa parisha, then pashu pakshyadi parisha. After vibhaga, what will be happening, that with close watching of the birds and animals, then the vibhaga parishas, karmas, how it will be taking place. So we can go one by one. First is the geographical understanding, how we can identify the peculiar geography, and through that geography how we can understand that this will be influencing the life forms that is existing in the particular areas. So we can see that first is the Parthiva Bhumi. If a land, if a geographical area which is having full of heavy rocks, big rocks are there, and it's having a blackish gray colored sand is there, then we can expect that this is a Parthiva Bhumi. So when you are going to a land and you are seeing that so many big black colored rocks are there, along with if you examine the soil of there, the soil is very blackish in color and it is having a Shyama Krishna Varna, and the plants that present is has having a plenty of big trunks, stula vriksha, huge trunk trees will be there. In such a bhumi is called as Parthiva. So if that Parthiva Bhumi, these features are present, then surely it will influence the life forms that are present in that area, especially the plants, because the plants are gathering these resources from the surroundings. So the Parthiva Bhumi plants will gather more Parthiva Tattva from that area, and plants will showing that predominance. So presently we can see that the moist evergreen forest of the world, different parts of the world, we can expect this type of Parthiva Bhumi predominance. And the next is the Apya Bhumi, and another terrain you are going and seeing that there will be plenty of water is there, Ambu Guna Bhuvishtam. And if you are examining the soil is Shukla Varnam, which is whitish in color, and Snigtham. If you take the soil in the hand and drop it, some of the sand particles will be stick on your eye hands. That is the Snigthatva it is present. And if you see the plants that is growing, plenty of plants will be there, which are having Komala Tranas, delicate stem and all these things. With the climbers will be there, small herbs will be there, moderate plants will be there, Vrishaga, like small trees will be there. like that, this is a specific terrain where there will be a predominance of aptato. So the plants also will have such type of predominance. So usually this you can see in seashore areas, moist wet evergreen forest where there will be heavy rain getting, and the riparian forest, the areas where near to the river beds, river banks. So a specific vegetation is there on the banks of the rivers, that is the riparian forest. Like that, Aapyabhumi has this predominance of this. That's why if you are examining also, you can see that there will be a plenty of plantains will be there, banana plants will be there, sugar cane plants will be there. All these are growing in such type of Aapyabhumi. And third is the Agneyabhumi. Here you can see that there are plenty of lighter stones, Laghu Amshavadi. And the soils are Nana Varnam, multicolored soil is there. And if you look into the flora, it's Alpa Vriksha, very restricted growth of the floras will be there. More of shrubs and other things, and Praroha, the plants are spreading on the land, which is are on the prostrate or in a offset like nature. Most of them are spreading on the ground surfaces. So Laghu Amshavadi, how we can examine means you take two stones of that particular area and crush it together, it will break very fast. And if you take some sand and wash in water, you can see that there will be a multicolor things. Yellow, red, black, white, all these combinations. This is the Agneyabhumi. So it can be compared to the desert dry scrub jungles. And if you see the Vayavyabhumi, it's rough in color. The soil is very rough in color, just like a pasma. And it is pasma samavarna, ruksha pasma samavarna. And the plants that is growing there means are small trees and thorny plants, kodara vriksha. The plant on that areas are having more thorns and xerophytic in nature, means it is having alparasa. If you squeeze out the stem or leaves, very little rasa can come out from. So like that, an area where there will be ruksha pasma samavarnam, rough ash color soil along with the small shrubs, and then more predominantly with the thorns and milky exudates sometimes on the stem, but the rasa present in these, the swarasa, we can't extract easily from these plants. So such a land is called the Vayavyabhumi. So when you are going through the trains or some traveling to a terrains of the jungle desham, you can expect this more. So there will be a flat land, and there will be pasma samavarna, the ash colored soil will be there, and more wind is blowing, and the plants are having more thorns and having a little amount of rasas on the leaves. So thorn scrub forests of India, especially the tropical dry deciduous forests, are having these types of Vayavyabhumi features. And another important bhumi is the Akashyabhumi. The soil and the sand are more mrudhi samam, and it is grayish black with the rocky mountains, Mahaparvata. So big height areas where there will be a black mountains and is having more sand on the surfaces of these rocks. Along with, if you taste the water of that particular area, it's Avyaktarasa Jala, tasteless water. And the plants that is presenting in that area has having a delicate heartwood. They are not growing in the height, but it will become shrubs and asara vriksha prayaha, not without a slender heartwood. So such a place is called as Agashyabhu. So we can expect this in the grasslands, shola grasslands, where there will be big stones will be there, blackish in color, along with the surface as having sand
compactly packed and having the taste of the water is very less. So this is one of the area where there will be a predominance of Akasha Mahabhuta. So Akasha Mahabhuta predominance is there, then the plants also will get that such type of predominance in the plant parts. So there's those plants which are growing on these grassland areas are not able to sustain in these environment only with these Akasha Mahabhuta. They need other Prithviya Tattvas also. So what they will do means, the plant already had a predominance of Akasha Tattva. The plant will gather the Prithviya Tattvas along with this Akasha inside their root and tubers and conserve all these energies in the root and tubers so that it will prevent the excessive expulsion of these Urdhva Mahabhutas, because Akasha Vayu like Tattva will go very fast and upward direction. So preventing that and conserving this in a form of a peculiar tuber or root and keeping their lives under the ground as having a high nutritive value, because the Tiktarasam as having Akasha Vayugunas along with, if you have a Madhura Rasa, then you will be a very nutritive. So if you look into the Ashtavargas like drugs, Jivaniyagana drugs, like they are growing in these types of Akasha Bhumi and they are having such type of things. So this can be observed in other plants also. A plant which is growing in Vayavya Bhumi has having a predominance of Vayu Mahabhuta. So Vayu Mahabhuta can't exist in its own form. So what they will take means, it will take a shelter on Prithvi Mahabhuta. So Prithvi Vayu will be taking a combination in this. So if you see the plants of the thorny scrub forests and a dry deciduous forest, they are having a predominance of Kashaya Rasa. So like that, we can infer and come to a Anumanam through our observational that Prithvi Mahabhuta or Ap Mahabhuta predominant area, they are the yonis or the sources of Madhura Rasa yonis, Madhura Amla, like that. And if it is Akashya Vayu Agnis, then it will be having a Kadu Rasa yonis. So like that, the basic understanding of a land or basic understanding of the ecology of a particular land can help to know about the basic character features of a plant. This is one of the primary assessment and gathering of the data what Ayurveda follows. So next, after seeing this, the combination of all these are taking place in certain land, then that is the Prashasta Bhumi, where we have the proper balance of these Mahabhutas. A flat land with a combination of red, black and white land soils, unjust in nature and devoid of big stones, and with plenty of water and excessive grasses, and hills are very less. So such type of land has having a mixture of Mahabhutas, and that mixture of Mahabhuta will influence innumerable lives. So the great floras of on the earth, where there will be a diversity of plant sources and species are there, they are having such type of mixing of these Mahabhutas and can be taken as a Prashasta Bhumi. The next thing comes is how we can understand this flora. The floral understanding is depending upon the nature of the plant. So again, we will use the observation of the plant. So observation is one of the important way to find out the new things. So if you sharpen your observation, it's ideal and best you can interpret new knowledges. So if you see a plant, the question will arise, why this plant is having a strong stem? Why this plant is become a small shrub? Why the leaf will be looking like this? why some of the plants are giving rise to too much of branches. So these are deciding by Panchabhautika principles. So for understanding that Panchabhautika principles will help to know about this plant part as having the predominance of this plant Panchabhautika principle. And then you can infer that this Panchabhautika principle in that plant can produce this specific type of rasa. So that's the way acharyas are first utilized to know about these things.
So if you going through an area and you are seeing that big trees are there without any branches, the stems are growing and producing big trees, you can imagine a place where there will be a nice falls and water is there, where you can imagine pines are growing very highly, or the devadarus which are growing in a water area of the high altitudes, the stem is growing like this. So the land itself is having a predominance of prati and aptattva. Because of that, the stems are having enough resources to gather from the bhumi. So Acharya is telling that yavat riju parigrahanadi tejas tavat riju agrandischa skandha. So if the tejas is very strong and then it will gather the prati of tattvas to the upward, and then that stem will be growing without any stunning growth straightly upwards and resulted into a big high stemmed plant. So pratyap tattva is gathered by tejas, and with the tejas activity it is growing upwards. Then we can expect that plant stem has having a predominance of tikta kashaya or tikta kashaya madhura like things, or kashaya madhura like things. Like that we can infer about that things. So if you see the devadara tikta kashaya galu, so that rasa, how it is coming? Because of the presence of that particular. Like that, by seeing the stem, we can infer the first thing. The second thing is, if you are, yes, how the porous nature of the stem is occurring. Yastra avasthita tejas kiyade. When the tejas present in that stem is reducing its activity, then vayu will supersede. And then the hollowness will be taking place. So that's why a plant which is growing in a mud, it has to come out in a watery area. It needs the more predominance of vayu akasha tattvas. So there the plant what will do means, they will little bit reduce the tejas so that vayu and akasha will supersede and it will come out from the water to gather the resources from the sun and other things. So that's why the lotuses flowers are having and leaves are coming outside. And if you see this, a plant which is growing in the aptatva area where there will be pratyapu is predominant, they are coming out from the water with the help of the vayu and the tejo mahabhutas, then it will having such type of rich combinations of the mahabhutas, especially with the tikta rasa predominant and having a kashaya rasa as the second thing, because of the prati is there and vayu is also there. So this kashaya tikta predominance is present in the flowers, the stamens, the leaves and everywhere. Because of that, this plant is one of the very good rakta sangrahi. It can prevent the bleeding also. So like this, we have to interconnect. So here by seeing this, we can able to say that this is having the predominance in this. Like that in the bamboos also. They are having the hollowness because of the predominance of vayu and agasa. Like that, wherever there will be an pitta will be, sejas will be reducing, then vayu will be supersede and will produce hollowness. Just why a certain plant is producing a branch at a particular level? You can see that. So a tree will be growing up to a level and then it will deciding that it has to give rise to branches. Yatra avasthita tejas ubhedo vichiddadadi
anilabhrithi ambasya avinarharati tatra dvidalam bhavati. So where the tejas residing in a particular area will produce an upayato viji. So at a particular level, when the tejas is reaching, and then the vayu will be superseding and it will dragging out all these mahabhutas to the side, then the branches will take place. So when you see a vividaki plant, how much branches are there, how it is happening? Because at a particular level, the tejas will be dragged out by the vayu, and vayu will taking out the pratyap tattvas to all the levels, and then it will be resulting in the branch. So again we can infer that there such type of a branching plant is there, then there will be a predominance of kashaya rasam. Like that, if you see a plant which is having a spreading nature from the ground itself, there also anila prati ambasis are taking out to the matter from the ground level itself. So there will be more predominance of pratyap tattvas by the tejas. So because of that, the bushes will be taking place. Like that, if you are seeing a bush, you can infer that there will be a predominance of pratyap tattvas along with the predominance of a tejo mahabhuta is there. And this can be an excellent drugs which can promote etiktam predominant with kashayam like that. And it can stimulate our agni also. So like that, if you see one and each and every part of the plant, we can infer if the thorns, if you see the branching areas, everywhere we can utilize this theory to find out the new such things. And one of the important area is the leaf shape. Leaf are the most predominant part we can observe in a plant. So if you see in a plant which is having a dirgha vritta tiriya chaturashram teja parigrahanat vashat patram, so tejas is deciding the shape. So you can see that the plant is having like this color and these activities because the tejas is activating more on this, because of that leaf will become incised and other things. So if you are seeing a leaf which is having a serration, which is having an incision, we can infer that it is having a predominance of tejo mahabhuta. So imagine a papaya leaf, imagine an eranda ricinus communis leaf, all these leaves are having such type of serrations and incisions because the tejo mahabhuta is predominant in this. So like that, if you look into these two plants, so one side you can see a plant which is having an incised leaf with kinetically composition. Another we can see, you can see there will be a simple leaf with a glossary appearance. So here, if you touch this, the first plant with the incisions and serrations, it will be two teja tattva is predominant and it can promote an itching to your body. But this side, this leaf will be very cooling in nature. So the first leaf which will be producing itching is the Gaurandavadi, Kairesha padeta, because of its teja is more predominant. The second leaf you are seeing is an entire leaf with a glossy shining appearance, Snigdhatvam. It is the Jivaga. So it is having very Snigdhatvam because of the predominance of Pratyudhatvas. So teja is less in this activity and here it is more. So like that, by seeing the plant itself, we can able to know that this plant is having more predominance of teja or other mahabhutas. Another is the compound leaves. How a compound leaf is occurring? Yatra avasthita tejas madhya upapidite anubodha varihiyade tatra patra shagam. So when there will be tejas in a particular area, is upapidite, it's become crushing like or constricting like, then the tejas will be dragged out to the sides and will lead to patra shaga, means on the petiole, when the tejas will be become a pedidam with the vadam, and then it will drag out all the things to the side and lead to epinetally compound leaf.
So Upapeetitam can be imagined if you are tightly catching a balloon with an air-filled balloon, and you can observe that if you are making too much of pressure between your fingers, the balloon will protrude. Like that, the tejas will be protruded to the sideways by the compression of the other Prathyadidha Mahabhudas, and it will lead to different shakas. So a pinnately compound leaf, if you are seeing, there will be a more predominance of tejas can accept along with the Prathyog combinations. So we can observe the leaves like Shikru, the leaves like Shonaga, Shonaga, Padala, Kaidariya, Neem, all these are having such type of tejo predominance along with the Prathvi. So we can expect a Tiktarasam along with a Kashayam on all these leaves. That is the compound leaves are forming. And next is the leaf venations, veins and veinlets. So Vetra Avastita Tejas Aneka Vijirda Dadi. On a point, if Tejas is producing more activity, then it will spread to all direction. Then Anila Prathya Ambasya Avinar Haradi. When it is spreading to all direction, it will drag out the Anila Prathis, Vayu and Prathi Tattvas to the sideways, and Patra Rekha Bhavati. So in a leaf, if you are expecting too much of veins and veinlets, we can infer that that leaf has having a predominance of again Tejo Tattvas are there. So like that, we can infer through venations also. We can utilize these things in Patra, Pushpa Kesara, Pushpa Karnika. So see, each and every part of the flower is described thousands of years back by our Acharyas. On that time, botany is not developed in that level. So Patra, Pushpa Patra, petals, Kesara, stamens, Karnika, the female organisms like that, style, stigma, and thalamus like things. So everything is occurring due to the activity of Tetra Avastita Tejas Aneka Vichirda Dadi Anila Pratyambasya Vinargaradi Tatra Pushpa Patra Kesara Karnika. So in petals, if the excessive Tejas activity will be there, then it will be taking out the Prathya and Adha Adi Mahabhudas, then so many petals will take place. The same in the stamens and all these things. So like that, some of the plants are having a peculiar type of petals which are less in number. Some of them are having innumerable number of petals. So these indicates that it is having a peculiar feature of Mahabhuda activities, especially the Tejo Mahabhuda activities. And here one more thing we have to look is the aspects of color of our matters and its influence in plants. So if you are seeing a plant which is having a more color features similar to that of black and black combination, you can expect that it is having a predominance of Prathya Mahabhuda. So black and black combination in the plant parts indicates Prathya Mahabhuda. If you seeing a plant which is having a blue and blue combinations, if the flower is blue, and then we can expect that that will be an Aptatva. So blue and blue combinations indicate the predominance of Aptatva. And if a plant is having a red combination and the parts are red in color, then it indicates that its Tejo Mahabhuda is predominant. So this is one of the thing that is utilizing by so many creatures of the world. So how they are differentiating a poisonous and non-poisonous things by this color. The plant also will utilize these techniques to keep away the organisms or the predators. Plant also will produce some of the parts with red in color so that it will produce a misunderstanding in the living beings that it is having a hot in potency. And sometimes the poisonous things itself is presented in the form of a red. So when the human beings are start their life in the forests, they are able to distinguish is this poison or not. One of the techniques they adopted is the color. So once it will be a red and red combinations, we think that it is having such type of things and we will keep away from that.
And once we will observe that this is eaten by some animals or birds, then only we will go to take that one. Otherwise, we will not take. And another color is the yellow color. If yellow and yellow combinations are predominant in the plant, we can infer that it's having the predominance of Vayu Mahabhuta. So you see our Aragadas, our Kasamarda, Chakramarda, Swarnakshi, Swarnabhatri, all cassias are, most of them are having yellow color. So they are having a Vayu predominance. Because of that, Vayu is having a Ruksha Lagu qualities, and we will use this for different stravas, itching and exudations that will be taking place in our body. We will use these types of yellow combinations. You can imagine turmeric. Turmeric is having a predominance of Vayu Mahabhuta. Because of that, it is having a Tikta Rasa, and it is useful in Medas and Kapha. Like that, we can infer through the color also. And if you are seeing a plant material which is transparent in nature, which is having a white or white combination along with the transparency, then we can infer that it is having the predominance of Akasha Mahabhuta. So when you're seeing a flower which is having a whitish in color combinations, we can expect that it can promote certain Bojovardhana or Rasayana qualities in our body. Or it can be act as a very good shamanam also. So like that, we can utilize this color techniques for identifying the various plant sources by color of the flower. So another example is Abrajita. So blue colored Abrajita, Clitoria ternata, we will use for Virajana purpose because the predominance of Aptattu. A white Abrajita we will use for Medhya purpose because it is having a predominance of Tejo Mahabhuta or Akasha Mahabhuta, along with that Akasha Mahabhuta. So like that, we can infer these plant sources into different level. We have Chitragam, Shweta Chitragam and Rekta Chitragams are there. Rekta Chitragam is very intensively acting on the blood. Shweta Chitragam is having an activity more through the Rasadadu and can increase the Ojas and Agni levels. Like that, we can use this technique for inferences, Anuvanas, and for coming to an assumption that this can be used for this purpose. So that color analog is also, color identification is also helped to gather some of the informations to the these things. Next, we have to observe some of the physiological activity that is taking place in the plants. Some of the leaves will be folding in the evening. Some of the leaf will be moving according through the sunlight. This indicates that there will be a predominance of Adhi, Aptattvam and Tejodattvam balance will be there in that plant. So, Sammilanam Adhi, the constriction of parts of the plant will lead to help of Aptattvam. The Aptattvam is helping in constrictions and foldings. Unmilanam Tejasa, the opening and blooming of these things are done by Tejo Mahabhuta. So, like that, this is a physiological thing that is going on a plant, then we can expect that that plant is having such type of balancing of these gunas. So if you seeing the touch me not plant, if you are touching, then it will be folding and sometimes it will be open after some time. So this indicates that it is having a balance of this hot and cold potency. That's why it is one of the good stambaram also. Like that, we can utilize various techniques, and one of the important technique and one of the easiest way of understanding the nature is Loga Purusha Samanyava. Whatever the thing is existing external, that is existing inside our body in a miniature form. So doctrine of signature. So the things that is making externally in the environment is by physical matters like Panchamahabhuta. In our body also, the Panchabhutika things along with the life making the matters. So the similarity of the structures with external and internal will help to take as a one of the important way to find out a new knowledge, a new invention. Because most of the time when you are going to study or discover a specific thing, you need a scientific analysis. So most of the scientific analysis needed for a discovery is an intuition. So from something is there, then we can build up some new knowledges. To work upon a peculiar knowledge, you need a certain stimulating knowledge from some sources. So one of the ideal thing is this Logavrusha Samanta. So in the photo, you on the slide, you are seeing a plant is called as Kudajam. It has having the bark as having folding similar to that of the bark of this, similar to that of the folds of the intestine. So when the excessive movement of the intestine is occurring, this plant's bark we will use it. So Kudajo Adhisare, or an antidysenteric for the excessive movement of our intestinal part. So how this Kudaja is getting that? Again, we can see that Kudaja is a plant which is growing more predominantly on Vayavya Prati predominant Desha. So it will gathering the Prati of Vayu Tattvas from that, and it will producing a very good Kashaya Rasam, and it will act as a very good Sapa. So this is one of the way. Another you can see is the simple example is the Central Asiatica. The similarity of this leaves with the brain, and you can utilize it for increasing the memory. And another plant you can see is here is the Pashanapeta. So you can see the habitat. So this photo is taken on the dry season so that you can able to see the plants. Otherwise, there will be a heavy flow of current flow of water through these things. And it's very difficult to sustain this environment. So the plant will produce the roots which can penetrate into the rocks. And it can stay on that particular areas by breaking the stones. So this is the Pashanapeta. We use this for reducing the stones that is occurring inside our body. Like this. Another example you can see is here you can see is the lichen. It's a combination of algae and fungi. So this type of a fungal infection is occurring on our body in the axillary region, a lichenification of these things, you can utilize this as the medicine. So modern studies also showing that this parmelia lichens are very effective in skin diseases. So like that, innumerable references are there to show that different analogies, color analogies, shape analogies, functional analogies, all these can impart a new knowledge to you for finding out these. This is not a complete knowledge what we are gathered. We have to analyze in other methods also. Another important step where we have to utilize is the Paraspara Prakriti Sambandha togetherness, looking into the nature to know about the interactions of the insects, know about the interactions of the ants with the plants and other things, so that we can able to know that this is good and this is bad. If you see are so many ants are there and it is covering a fruit and so many ants are residing in a plant, we can infer that plant has having so much of nutritive things. We can use that nutritive for this particular purposes that is essential to our body. And then after assessing these, we will coming to a knowledge that this is having these types of predominance. So these are the various steps we are adopted to gather the information. So now we have an innumerable information step by step that this plant is having this predominance and it's growing in this area and this is having these types of Mahabhuta. So these statistical inferences is true or false. We have to check it in another level. So for that purpose, we will go for the perceptional understand.
Good answer. Then we will assess the viryas. So the virya, how it will be, it's Ushna or Shita like that. After that, these things. So after that virya assessment only, we can able to know that this is having this potency and this. So whatever the findings that is gathered from the first thing to this, we will having a very good knowledge that. So probably this is the most predominant percentage of assumption. And then we will standardize this with the RAS assessment.
So if you are trespassing the above method, then we will land. If you first, we will start with RS assessment. Then sometimes there may be a poisonous or a irritant substance. Then it can create a problems. So this step, if we are adopting, then we can surely found that this can be, this rasa is the main rasa that is present. And whatever the things what we are found from the first to till now is the correct one. This is one of the main identifying feature or standardizing feature of our assessment of the rivers. And again also, after combination with the Agni, there will be a transformation is taking place. We can't say that this is will be, this Agni will convert this matter into this level. Only our constant observations and inference and looking into the karma only we can able to know this. For that, it is the Pashupakshi Parisha is very much necessary. Looking into the nature, that how the animals and birds are responding to that, and how they are eating, and after eating, what they are showing their activities, that we have to look and incorporate that one. So like that, till now also, if you see, the Vaidyas are utilizing these techniques for various assessments, giving the medicines to the domestic animals, goat, milk, goat, cows, like that things, and observing them, is it they are producing more urine or feces like things, or they are secreting more milk, or they are having more energies, then it will be a moderate problem. If they are producing a little amount of milk and they are losing their hairs or something like that, then it will be a kadu problem. So like that, the assessments is necessary and it will take a long procedure of observation and research. So by that, only we can able to know that this drug can be used for this purpose. So Acharyas are also followed these things and documented this. Because of that, you can see that Shara, Lavana, Pippali. So Pippali is considered to be one of the very good drug and rasayana. But afterwards, they come across with that excessive intake of the Pippali in the form of a food may lead to some problems. So they told that it should be taken as a food material, as like that of other kadu rasas, because it can produce utklesham, excessive utklesham in our body. So like that, the vipaka assessment is also one of the important thing. It needs a long observation and other things. By these, acharyas are come to conclusion that in each desha, each type of foods and each diseases, each type of medicines are ideal for these purposes. So it will take a long continuous process of observation, inference, usage of yukti along with aptobhadesha. Then only we can find out the correct way of assessing, studying and documenting of the things that is existed in the Ayurveda. Still it is possible to find out these things with these principles, because nowadays we have so many colleges, so many students and so many people are working day and night in the field of Ayurveda. So if we use these techniques in a correct pathway, these theories and possibilities in a correct pathway, surely it can open up new research fields and we can find out new things. So we can see that some of the examples, if you see the history of Google, it is a jangala desha utpanna. So in a jangala desha, this plant has to sustain. For that purpose, they have to store some nutritive things. So in jangala desha, we know that in a dry land where there will be agasha and vayu is predominant along with agni. So agni vayu predominant area, it's very difficult to store the apratyab tattvas. So they converted the pratyab tattvas into a particular mahabhuta predominant tejo vayus. So we will get an oleogam rasin that will be having a very good activity to clear out our rodasas and reduce the medhas, because it is having a predominance of tejas and vayu. Like that, if you see some other plants that are available in the Western Ghats, like these plants, which is yielding a red fruits, and these fruits are eaten by elephants, monkeys, and all these things. So it shows that the tortoise are coming and eating more of this. So tortoise is one of the creatures which is having a long lifespan. So that much of nutritive things are existing in this. Local peoples are also using this. So we can also see that using the Panchabhautika theories and assessing the taste of this, it is having a multi-taste, just like Amalaki, Amala Pradhana Madhura. So it will be a very good rasayana. The local peoples are also using this plant for that rasayana purposes. And you can see the growth of Jivaga-like plants. Such plants are only coming out in the visible life forms for 3 months. The other 9 months, they are under the ground in a hibernization, just like a samadhi of something. And then again, it will regenerate when the favorable situations are coming. So the Jivaga, Rishabhaga like drugs, which is having such a potency, can produce such type of life promoting things in our body also. So like that, if you are seeing, there are innumerable examples are there which can be utilized for these purposes. You can see another example is this strychnus. So we know that strychnus naxomica is a very poisonous thing, and it is having so many good qualities to reduce the pain and inflammations. So in the field, you can see that another plant of the strychnus colubrianum, a big climber like plant, which is also having such type of fruits and seeds that also can be used for these purposes. So we have to look and study these things in these levels, and we can able to know that this can be used for this. This is one of the variety of Mrishtika, Jadi Phala, a wild nutmeg. So that also has having a too much of hot potency. If you make a punch on the bark of that plant, you can see that it will yield a blood color. So it may be one of the very good source that can be used for blood related problems. And you can see another plant which is growing on the Jangaladesha. So these plants, like this variety of flowers, indicative towards the activity of more tejas, the color. And you can see that the stem also is very fleshy in nature, and it eaten by the animals. So all these indicate that it is having a very good nutritive value. It can be used as a food. The local peoples are using this for a food purpose to reduce their appetite and reduce their body bulkiness. But it is a very good nutritive too. So a plant which is growing in a dry land, by conserving all its energy in the stem, will become edible and can be used to increase our agni and can supply most needed proteins and other things that is for our body existence. So like that, we have a plenty of plant sources are existing. Only thing is, we have to look in the proper manner. Sarvalogatma anyatma sarvaloge samanu vashyadi satya buddhi prabhosambhute. So seeing the entire universe in the self and vice versa give rise to the true knowledges. So observe, increase the capacity of to observe the external environment, and you increase the capacity to infer it with your yukti and aptobhadesha, then surely we can find out new things. That's the way that acharyas are showing. We have a plenty of work has to be done, because nowadays you can see that the complete environmental scenario is changing. The world population is going to different crises. So it is necessary to find out the plant sources from their own lands, and we have to conserve the environment in their own places. If such a thing is not taking place, it will hardly hit out this blue planet Earth, and it may lead to the restriction of the life forms in their planet. So for that, it is essential to utilize these concepts not only for treatment or a drug discovery. These concepts has to be utilized to preserve the environment that is essential for these types of growth. Why means, if an environment is loose, then the plant that is living in that particular condition is also will lose its potency. That's why Acharyas in Janapadvamsa, it is telling that if a Janapadvamsa is coming and then you are going to collect that plant, the plant will not having that much of area because it is loose in that land itself because of the dushita of vayu, jala, agni and prithvi. So that dushita will interrupt the actions of the plants. So we have to protect this environment and then only we have to get the ideal peace and life on this planet. So thanking one and all, especially our students of the Ashtanga Upasana Group and the College Union for giving an opportunity to share this to the possible peoples that who are sharing this. And at the same time, it is a blessings from the gurus to share these things to all of you. Thanking all and one and all for patience hearing, and we can go through some of the discussions if you want, or some doubts if you want to share.
Thank you, sir. Hello, sir. Can you hear?
Yes, yes.
Hello.
Yeah.
Okay. Thanks for this wonderful session, sir. I think now we can move on to the doubts of our delegates.
Yes, yes, sure. Thank you.
Till now, no doubts were there in the chat section. Delegates, you can share your doubts on the chat column. It will be addressed one after the other. Delegates, you can share your doubts on the chat column. Okay, sir, one doubt is there. Sir, how to assess the virya of a new drug?
Yes. First, we have to go through the assessment of the plant. If you're seeing that plant material, you have to assess that, how the shape of that. So if it is having a peculiar shapes, and it's having a peculiar varna that is more striking to you, and it is showing a peculiar luster, pa varna, two words are used to denote the tejo mahabhuta. Pa means a luster, a shining nature. Varna means a color. So these two things are existing in a plant along with a multiple dimension of that shape. Then we can infer that it is having a tejo mahabhuta properties. So example, you can take a simple example that if you are seeing a leaf which is having a serrations and incisions more, and it is showing a shining nature, and it is emitting a peculiar type of glow in the surface of the leaf, then it is having a predominance of tejo mahabhuta. If you are seeing a stem part, for example, you can see that if you are seeing a devadaru, if you are seeing, you can see that it is having a peculiar shape and it is having a peculiar type of glow and shining nature. This indicates that it is having a tejo mahabhuta. This is the first exception we will do. Then we have to go for the guna assessments. On the guna also, we have found that it is having a snigdhatvam, gurutvam and all these things. And then from that, which is the most predominant, we have to assess. That is the virya. Nipadaschanulabdhade. So it, why the contact, how you are feeling. The first you have to touch that one with your fingers. So then you are feeling a coldness, then means it is a cold in potency. But you don't stop. Then you have to apply it in the nail buds, between the nails. So there also you are feeling a coldness. Then we can confirm somewhat where it is very cool in nature. But if you are producing some burning sensation, then you can fear that it is having a ushnato. And then again, you have to apply it in the back of the ear.
So there again, it is producing a coolness, then you can confirm that it is cold. Again, you have to apply it in the soft tissues like lips or the tongue areas. You can feel that it will be cool there itself also. Then it will be Shita importance. This is the one way to assess this. If it is producing the hotness by first applying in your skin itself, then you can infer that it is too hot. You have to reduce that hotness. You have to go for the dilutions of these things till to extents. So if you are taking 5 grams and 50 ml of water, then again do that one. Then also it will producing a heatness, burning sensations. Then again you have to dilute that water with that. Then again you have to assess. Like that, you can find out the range of that Ushnatva. Then only we can able to diagnose that this is having a very good Ushnatva or a very less Ushnatva or medium Ushnatva like that. Like that, we have to assess the areas.
Okay, sir. Now the next question is, could you please discuss the Pashana Veda again?
Pashana Vedas are a group of drugs. If you see in our Ayurveda, you can see that numerous sources of the plants are mentioned in the name of Pashana Veda. Rotula Akatica is there, Virginia Lingulata will be there, Scoparia dulcis will be there. Like that, numerous plants are there. Why all these plants are taken as Pashana Veda? Even if you look into the Nigandus also, Pashana Vedam, Vadapatra Pashana Vedam, Shudra Pashana Vedam, like that, sources are there. So all these plants are having a specific pharmacological property to break the stones that is present in our renal systems. So how the plant is getting all these means from their place where they are growing. So a plant which is growing in that particular stone with penetrating their roots and breaking out the roots, the plant is growing. Then we can infer that the plant roots are having such a strong chemicals, constituents or rasaguna viryas which can break the stones. That what we are using for our purpose. So a plant which is growing in the high altitude, like in the Himalayas where the stones and the snowfalls are there, there the Virginia lingulata is growing. It's growing by breaking the stones and producing the deep roots into the stones. So that is the Vadapatra Pashana Veda. If you come to South India, on the rivers, between the stones, another plant is growing by breaking the stones. That is Rotula Akatica. That is another source for that. Like that, in whatever the habitats, by looking into the analogies of the nature of the work or the functional aspects that is doing in that particular land, that we can infer that this can be used for this purpose. So if you are come across with another plant, nowadays you can see that bryophyllums are using for breaking the stones. If you see the natural habitat of these bryophyllums, they are growing in the creeps of the rocks or on the surface of the rocks by little bit breaking the rocks itself. So that can be also one of the sources of breaking the stones. Like that, we can utilize the plant sources for these purposes.
Okay, sir. The next question is, sir, since these days people travel from one place to another, like Jangala to Anuba, how should we decide the treatment in such patients with respect to both Ahara and Aushadha?
So in respect to their nature, so there will be two things we have to take and consider that. In which place the person has grown up? So in which desha? So surely that will influence. So in the Balavastha, if someone is growing in a Jangala desha, that surely influence that person's Balavastha. And his body is creating the most predominance with that things that existed in that areas. So that's why Ajarayas is describing Desha Parisha is one of the important thing. First is the external Desha where they are growing and the Athura Desha. So that we have to look. And if you are, if a person is grown up in an Jangaladesham and he is coming to an Anupadesham, there we have to consider that if he is continuously staying in the Anupadesham for another more than 90 days, it's a possibility of adapting to that particular area. So like that, if he is staying in a particular place and then using the Anupadeshaja Ahara Viharas, then it can influence that person. And some extent it can change the body constitution and strength of the person. It not means that completely it is changing, but little bit change will be occurring and the body will try to adjust in that. That is the capacity of the human bodies, along with the mind and the nature has happily taken place. So there, when you are going to administrate, so another thing we have to consider is he is coming to the Anupadesham also. He is practicing a Jangaladesha food. He is continuously to be more comfortable with that food. Then he is not changing that much. So we, his koshta and his body nature, body prakritam, and all these things will try to compensate with this Anupadesha. It will not changing completely, but try to compensate with the same desha. And certain extent, the most percentage, 70 to 60% like that, we can sell, he can adopt to this particular level. That's the capacity of human beings. But once you selecting the medicines, we have to peculiar that certain medicines will not be very ideal for, not ideal for these types of persons. So if you are giving a Jangaladesha person more medicines that will be using in Anupadesha, may not work it out. Example, you can take that if you are taking one spoon of Kritam in Anupadesha, it is very enough to make a Snigdhatvam daily basis. But in the Jangaladesha, they need more Kritam to make it in a Snigdha form. So that's the energy that is utilizing in that particular area by the humans. So like that, medicines also having such type of variations. So like that, we have to infer on that. And another important thing is, when you are searching the medicines for Jangaladesham and Anupadesham also, we can utilize these principles. And by that, we can come to a conclusion that Jangaladesha medicines are essential for this disease, then we have to collect from Jangaladesha. And Anupadesha medicines are essential, then it has to be collected from Anupadesha. Especially this can be seen very much in our Panchakarma treatments. Amana Ushada is collecting from the Jangaladesham, Virajana Ushada is collecting from the Anupadesha, because we need such type of Mahabuddha predominance in particular karmas. Like that, we have to utilize our yukti, our observational techniques, and what are the changes that are occurring on the person through Agni, Vayu, Vaya, Satmya, Sattva. All these factors also will come into play in these conditions. And then only we have to give the medicines or food to such type of persons.
Okay, sir. Okay. Now the next question. Next question is, sir, for a plant, for each part may show different Panchamahabhuta predominance. So, how can we tell the Mahabhuta predominance as a whole?
As a whole, we have to analyze. Each plant surely has having different predominance. But again, we have to look into the overall assessment of that. Overall assessment of all these things. And then we can able to know that this Mahabhuta is predominant in this. So again, we have to start it from the particular desha. Then you have to see that this is the predominance that is seeing in this plant. And then overall, you can say that this is plant as having these types of features and this Mahabhuta is predominant. But it doesn't mean that each part we have to assess, because we are using in different parts that plant. There we have to go for the sushma assessment of each plant is also necessary. Grossly, if you are coming to a conclusion that this plant can have it, this Mahabhuta, means it may produce some wrong informations. So it is better to analyze each and every small parts of the plants and then only we have to come to a conclusion that this plant has having an overall these things. So in the case of small plants, we can say that Chuba varieties, small plants, we can say that the whole plant will possess such type of Mahabuddha predominance. Once the Mahabuddha predominance start to accumulate more and the plants become a sthula, a very gross plants, then it's very difficult to analyze the plant parts, because that much of diversity of panchabhautika things are happening in the plants. So a big life means that much of diversity is there. A small size means the panchabhautika diversity will be less, because of the paraspara anupravesha, anugraha, upasarga, like that things are there.
Okay. Sir, can you please explain that guna slide again? I think at that portion some network issues were there.
Okay. So, guna, we know that there will be the gunas are there. Are you able to see the slide?
Yes, sir.
Are you able to see this? Okay. So, guna, we have 20 gunas are there. 10 gunas on one side and the opposite 10 gunas are there on the other side. So, everywhere in the dravyas, these gunas are applied. So, to identify the panchabhautika principles also, we are using these gunas. So, how we can assess the gunas through our panchendriyas? So, and the panchendriya artha janas. So we have to exploit all these with our perceptional usages, the touch, smell, sense, tattva, and all these things. For the basics, we can say that if you are touching a plant material which is having a very harsh and rough in nature, you are closing your eyes and touching this, it's very harsh and rough in nature, we can imagine that it is having a predominance of Ayu Mahabuddha. And if you are touching a material, it is very smooth and glittery in nature, and snigdhatva will be there. It is having a predominance of aptatva or pratidhatva like that. So this can impart the sparsha gunas. So through sparsha, you can know about these things. And when you are seeing that also, if it, by the colors and the agrati also, you can able to know. And if you smelling that, if it is emitting a very good smell, then is having the predominance of Prithvi Mahabuddha. So if it is not producing the smells, then it is having a less other Mahabuddhas. And if you are making a sound also, it will producing a very hard sound and laudable sound, then it will be having the predominance of Agasha Mahabuddha. Like that, we have to utilize all these things along with the taste. That is the one way. Another way is you have to do the physical experiments of the particular part material, particular dravyas, in the form of putting it in the air, because everything in the universe, especially in the earth, in the context of earth, we are discussing the Ayurvedic science. So in the context of the earth, all the things are karya dravya and it is completely under the influence of the laws of nature, especially the gravitational force. So we are understanding all these gunas on the basis of the physical thing that is existing in the earth with the special reference to gravity. So adapadana karanam guru gunam. So it indicates that adapadanatvam, the gravity is deciding the main gurutva. Heaviness is decided by this. So thousands of years back itself, before Isaac Newton, we are able to know that this is the thing that is happening in the physical matters. This is the one form of assessing. So we will assess through the water. So if you are putting a material in the air, it will be flowing like this, then it is lagu. But it is flowing with a sound, it is guru. We have to again assess that how much gurutvam is there. You have to put it in the another medium, water. So again, it will be coming downwards, then it shows that it is having more heaviness. then again we will not stop, we will put it in the taila. There again it will be sing on the top downwards, then it can indicate that it is having more gurutva. And then again we will put it in the gurutva. Again it is coming down, so it shows that it is having a uttama guru gunam, a more heaviness in nature. Like that we have to assess each and every part with each and every gunas, then we can able to know that this is the guna predominant in this. Okay.
Okay, sir. Now we can move on to the next question. Sir, you said Vayu and Teja Mahabhudas means Tikta Rasa, but normally it represents Kadu Rasa. How to make difference with both Rasa? Please explain that, sir.
Of course, the Kadu Rasa is having the more predominance of Vayu and Agni Mahabhuda, Teja Mahabhuda. So these Vayu, Teja and Agasha Mahabhudas are closely related Mahabhudas because of its duksha chida, sorry, duksha laghu gunas. So the difference wherever it is coming means the duksha laghutvam is present in Agasha and the same time in the Vayu. So Vayu has duksha laghutva vishada, Agasha has duksha laghutva and ushma guna. So these minute difference only there. So there may be always a combination of these things will be existing in each Mahabhuta. So if you are telling that we are telling that this is having a Tikta Rasa means it is having a predominance of Vayu Akasha, surely. But surely it is having an assistance of Teja also. But it is not precipitated well. So we will call it as a Tikta Pradhana or like that. But if you look in the things, it is always having a support of this. But a Kadurasa Dravyam, there will be more predominance of Tejas along with Vayu. That's why we will consider that as having more Ushnato and it can promote such type of karmas in our body where the Hanam, Pajanam, all these things are essential. Like that difference as we have to understand. But as a whole we are speaking, surely Kadurasa is having these types of things and the Tejo and the sorry, Vayu and Agasha is having the Tikta Rasa predominance.
Okay, sir. Another doubt is, sir, whether...
One more thing.
Okay.
If you see that Charakacharya, Sushrutacharya's explanation about the Shamana Aushadam, Shamana Aushada has having the predominance of Agashiya Mahabhuta. So Agasha Vayu Mahabhuda predominant is the Tikta Rasa, and Tikta Rasa is more extensively used for that purposes. Kadu Rasa is the best drug for Deepana and in Pitta. So there it is having a predominance of Agni and Vayu, so it is having capable to increase that one. So like that, in the Rasas and in the Karmas, we have to depend upon these things, and that is existing in the plants in the form of some Taradamayo ranges. So everywhere this is there, but something is predominant that will be highlighting more. So that is the Vipadeshas to Huyasa what we are using.
Yes. Okay, sir, can we move on to the next question?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yes. So one had asked that whether all the slogans explained above are references from Rasa Vaisheshika.
The first two slogans regarding the geographical explanations are came from the Sushrutacharyas, and the other things what the slogans are mentioned is from Rasa Vaisheshika Sutta. And whatever the things of about the Rasa Guna Virya Vibhaga all came from our Samhitas. But these things are there in Rasa Vaisheshika Sutra also in a different form. But it is not like in that what it is mentioned in the Ayurvedic books. So it is easy to understand the things if you combine both these things. Only if you go to the Rasa Vaisheshika Sutra, sometimes we can feel difficult to understand these concepts. So both, if you are going through a balance, then surely we can able to know, and we can still, there will be so much of possibility to find out new ideas.
Okay, few more doubts are there, sir. I think we can address that. Now the next question is, if a specific plant doesn't attract flies and birds but are still edible, what should we infer?
It will be inferred in two ways. One is the insects and butterflies are not attracting, means it is having that much of chemicals that is not favorable for that particular creatures. And we have to also look that if such a thing is there, most of the time our body is also not able to digest or assimilate that such type of things. So we have to utilize the samskara of that karma, samskara techniques to that plant, and then we will cook it, or we will use some process by drying or keeping it in the water or something like that. Then make certain preparatory methods and make it a favorable thing to our body, and then we will consume. It can be useful for our body. Otherwise, in the most of the time, if you are consuming directly such type of things, it is very heavy to digest by our body, and it may lead to so many complications. Even if you are feeling that such things, it's not making anything, and we are, our agni is digesting all these things. But once it's undergoing a vipaga and in the mala formation, there may be a chances of converting these matters into another law. So such things usually will go to another category, that it may produce some side effects. So surely you look into these aspects by multi-dimensional, multi views to assess the plants, and then only we have to use that things, because nature is such a complex things, and a complex interactions are going on. So it is not easy to study, assess, and come to a conclusion that it should be like this and it can be used by like this. It needs a constant studies and observations, and after that only we can able to tell that it has to be there. So here comes the importance of ahara and aushadha concepts. So ahara, you can observe these things and you can use. When you are coming to an aushadha, it should be a good knowledge of these things should be there. So there the importance of jnanam and vijnanam. Vijnanam is the true knowledge. The true knowledge of a particular information is necessary for using as a medicine. So these things also we have to taking into consideration, and then we have to decide that it has to be used for these purposes.
Okay, sir. If we consider various parts of the plant like patra, moola, phala, etc., most of the time they show difference in rasapanjagas. Example, yes. Aragadatak and bhala. Why is it happening, yes, so?
Because the plant needs such type of things for existing in the life. In our body also you can see that our hairs are growing in the head and in other particular areas. It has having a specific need. And we have so many secretions in our mouth. That secretions are totally different in other parts of our body. So that is the need of a life in this particular environment. Like that, plants also having such type of things that is essential. So if they want to stand in a particular land with their roots, they have to adopt to that particular peculiar root system in that land that will be ideal for existing in that land. So they will produce such type of root systems. So if the plant want to reproduce or produce their offsprings to a next generation, they want to protect their seeds in a peculiar type of pots, coverings. For that purpose, their seed covering will be produced on the roots of the aragoda. So the birds have to attract to that one, and the birds will eat that sweet pulp. Along with that, they will eat the seeds also. So that is the technique of the birds. So techniques of the plants to attract and use the animal kingdom for another purpose. So that seed will be going through the gut of the birds, and then it is excreting, and it will give rise to a new plant. So according to the needs, the antachedana dravyas, the utpita dravyas that existing in the land has having so many peculiar characteristics. So by their needs, they will conserve their energy, and according to the situations, they will use the energy to their particular areas. Sometimes they will shed the leaves. Why they are shedding the leaves? They know that this is the time to conserve the energy in other parts, so that they will shed off the leaves. But the jangama life has have not having that things. They are under bahichetanas. They are using, like are we using our so much of energy for so many purposes, and we are losing that also. But the plants has having a capacity to utilized in the more sustainable way to give it to the needs of the surroundings. That is the special.
Okay, sir. Can you please give an example of black combination flowers, which is Prithvi Mahabhuta?
We can see so many things on black combinations. There are so many black combinating things will be there, but only important thing is the stones and other things we can, what the things we can able to consume. If you see some of the stones, vajra, gems and other things are having a black and black like combinations, it's very hard in nature, but we can't use that in any purposes. So if only the Prithvi Mahabhuta is predominant, it's very difficult to use it in for the purposes. So we have to convert that Prithvi Mahabhuta and other things, and then only our Agni can able to convert these things. So most of the time, we have to utilize these techniques for identifying the plant parts. Then the predominance of black and black combinations we can select. That's why the some of the rasayana dravyas which are having a blackish combinations are considered to be the best ones, and they are most of the time rare also. It's very difficult to get. So like that, black things as having such type of predominance of Prithvi Mahabhuta. So some example we can take is agaru. Agaru's bark are very hard and blackish in color. That's because of the presence of Prithvi Mahabhuta more. And it is kashaya rasam also. If you see the barks of the internal barks of the ficus variety plants, there also you can expect that type of black combination. So these things, if we layer, then you can expect that that is having a Prithvi Mahabhuta predominance. And when you are seeing some of the things are decay, it is converting into a blackish color. So that means it is converting to a Prithvi Mahabhuta more, and it is starting to deteriorate. So when a banana is turning to too black, means its Prithvi Mahabhuta is starting to produce more, and it is not good sometimes to our body. And then again that conversion of the Mahabhudas will be taking place, and it will be deteriorating. That Prithvi Mahabhuta will break into another forms, and it will be decay and completely along with the our earth or other substances. Like that, conversions will be taking place. And you can see this is features in our human body also. In certain disease vasadhya conditions, the blackish colorations will be showing that the functional aspect of the body is decreasing, and more prithitattva is taking place more, and it is blocking our srodhasas and shutting down the transmission of the teja, vayu, akasha like things. That will lead to the stagnation of the Mahabhudas to particular level, and it will become blackish in color. So like that, everywhere we can expect that.
Okay, sir. Sir, Amalagi is considered as one among the best rasayana, but many elders say we should not grow Amalagi in home. Some say it is due to vastu reasons, and some say its root affects the foundation of home, etc. What is the reason, sir? If it's a nitya rasayana, why not grow it in home?
Surely it can be grown in homes. Nowhere in our literatures such a information is available. So when I referred to these books like various Vriksha Ayurveda, various books, the literature that is mentioned in the Vedas, and till now I am not able to found such a type of information, and I don't know about that some traditional way of thinking is there or not, but till now I didn't found like that. But I found that we can see also, everyone, if you are going through these literatures, you can see such type of things are not mentioned for these types of plants. Vicus plants, those which are having a shiri vrikshas and kandaka vrikshas, can produce little bit of harmness to the environment where the human beings are living. That plants can be a problems, but these types of things in Kerala, especially in the South India, and we have a very good custom that if you growing a amalaki near to the well, means it will be good to the water and other things. So like that, it's a possibility. And everywhere, if you look in the villages, you can see that near to the houses they are growing the amalaki. It's not a problem, but growing a ficus variety ashwatha vada udumbara is not a good thing to the near to the house. I think most probably this is the thoughts that existing in the villages, not the regarding the amalaki.
Okay, sir. Now, is there any chapters in any nighandu dedicated for the principles which you have mentioned about deciphering pharmacology based on morphology?
Nighandus, it is not possible to mention everything in every part. Nighandus are having a specific aim to give the knowledge about the discovered things. There we can expect such type of things in that nighandus. Why the nighandu is manufactured means nighandu is able to know about the plant identification, what it is already done, along with its pharmacological and actions and its therapeutic utility. That is the purpose of the nighandu. So each book has each these purposes are there. Accordingly, the acharyas are things. So we can't found anything, everything on one place. So if you want to study pharmacology, we have to study the pharmacological books. If you want to study the phytochemical and chemical structures, we have to go to the chemical books, chemistry books. So like that in Ayurveda also, we have so much of literatures that can be spread around, which everywhere it's done with the specialties. Certain specialties there for certain special areas. So if you look into the Vriksha Ayurveda like books, you can see that there will be a wide concept of utilizing the plants with the environment and with the other growth factors. That can't be expected in an Ayurveda Samhitas or anywhere. So everything we have to gather from the available resources, then only we can able to know about these things. So you can know that there will be Bhuda Vidyas are there. There will be a Krishi Vijnanas are there. Animal husbandries are there. So these are we are losing because we are not entering into the essential other factors that good for Ayurvedic peoples and community. So there also we have to look. So surely in Nighandus we can get scanned. Especially in Taja Nighandu we can get some of the reference, but it is not ideal to expect everything in that part. We have to look into other books also.
Okay, sir. Two more doubts are there. I think we can address that also, right, sir?
Oh yes.
Okay. There is a common saying that Ayurveda Kashtaushadhi is first worsen the condition, then only undergo shamana. Why is it so?
One more, please repeat that one. Please repeat that question.
There is a common saying that Ayurveda Kashtaushadhi is first worsen the condition, then only undergo shamana. Why is it so?
No, such a saying is not where it's such a saying. It's not like that. It's a fault if we are saying like that and it we are doing the wrong thing. It is not like that. Sadhya Phalavatta action. It's not like that. Don't think like that it will act afterwards like that. It's depending upon the dosha rupas of mochanam and the srodhasas and where it is occurring and how much problem that is created like that. It's not like the other way.
Now the last question is, so if you want to know the gunas of a new oil such as sunflower or olive oil, or a new preparation such as processed coconut oil, then can we assess them using these tests you mentioned and get their rasa panchaka?
Yeah, along with this, we have to utilize the other techniques also. We have to examine these. Basically, we can utilize these things, but along with that, we have to utilize to give these things to the domestic animals. And one more important thing, till now we are discussed is regarding the places where it is growing. Sunflower is a plant which is growing in a particular jungle desha. And how the plant will appears like that. And each taila has having a specific gunas, rasa, vidya. Accordingly, we have to select that this has to be used for these type of purposes. So a taila with anushna vidyam, madhura rasam, and madhura vipagam is ideal for most of the peoples. That's why we are preparing the coconut oil. And it is hridyam too. But a kadurasa anubandha madhura rasa dravya taila, which is having an ushnatvam or anushnatvam, maybe not an ideal thing to consume for always and every time. We are not consuming these oils in a fresh form. We are consuming by processing and adding with some other drugs also, other materials also. For correct giving assessment, we have to look into these principles only. And then nowadays, we have so many other new techniques to know about the plants. So why can't we can utilize that also? So the most of the other related chemicals that assist in the different oils is available nowadays. Along with this, you can use these translational researches that is available in other sciences, and that can also be utilized. So there is no restriction that we can't use any knowledges of any other systems or other branches. We can utilize whatever the things that is available. That is essential for the growth of everything. We can use these techniques and advanced techniques also.
Okay, sir, I think we can conclude the session here. Our scheduled time has already been exceeded.
Okay,
once again, thanks for this wonderful and brainstorming classes, sir. And during the session, some technical issues were there due to network issues. Please pardon for that. And thanks for all your patience, presence, and asking these wonderful questions which make our initiative successful. Once again, thanks, sir, for this wonderful session.
Thank you one and all, and especially thank you to Rohit, sir, for arranging these things. Thank you.
Okay, I think we can end our session here.
Yeah.